All right, thank you, Titus. All right, good evening. Could you turn your Bibles to Daniel chapter 11, verse 29? In my notes, I have verse 21, and I have verses 21 through 34 in my notes, but I want to start us at verse 29, not at verse 21. So if you could turn both in your Bibles and my translation to Daniel chapter 11, verse 29. We're going to be noting verse 34 this evening. Next Tuesday will be the final class on the prophecies concerning Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth. Then next Wednesday we'll be starting the prophecies concerning the Antichrist, and that will bring us into the final section of the book of Daniel, and we should be finished with Daniel. It looks like sometime in September, maybe even before that. And then I haven't decided yet if I'll do a particular subject or subjects in between books. But the next book I want to do after Daniel during the weekday classes is 2 Timothy. So that'll be our coming attraction. So this evening we have our prayer meeting at the end of classes. We normally do on Thursday. And I might do a little question and answer session might cut the class. Well, I might get done a little sooner than usual, so I might do a little question and answer session. So just give you a heads up on that. That's okay. You never know, I might not do it, but there's a good chance I will do it. I just want to see where you guys are at and your understanding of the chapter thus far. So with that in mind, let's take a moment of silent prayer, as is our custom. We take this moment of silent prayer to confess our sins if necessary. This recovers the filling of the Spirit and our fellowship with God, which are both maintained by bringing our thoughts into obedience to the Spirit who speaks to us through the teaching of the Word of God. And the Word of God He has inspired, according to 2 Peter 1:20 and 21. So with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given to us. We thank you for another day to study your word. We thank you for this study in the book of Daniel. We pray that the Holy Spirit would continue to guide us and direct us in this study. We pray that it would be a blessing to your people. And also this evening, of course, we pray that the Holy Spirit would help everyone to understand what is being taught this evening and to make application, to be sensitive to the Spirit's guidance and direction. We also pray, Father, that you would help myself as the communicator to speak clearly and concisely and with accuracy and clarity, reverence, respect, and power. And we just pray, Father, that also that you would help Titus with the sound and the recordings, the video and the audio. We thank you for his service and the technology that you've given to us. We also thank you for the hospitality of Titus and Jody Thompson and opening up their home to us. We pray that this Bible class would bring glory to you and your son, Jesus Christ. In our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. This evening we're going to note Daniel chapter 11, verse 34, as I said before the opening prayer. Next Tuesday we'll do verse 35, and that will complete the prophecies regarding Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth, which began in verse 21 and are completed again in verse 35. They were fulfilled in the second century B.C. between the years 174 and 164 B.C. Then in verse 36 through 45, the rest of the chapter, we have the prophecies concerning the character and actions of Antichrist during the last 3.5 years of the 70th week. And then we go into the chapter 12, which talks about the preparations for the millennium and also the tribulation period, the last 3.5 years, and Michael's relationship to it. And so we have a lot of cool stuff that'll be coming up in the future. This evening, we're continuing to note this again, this prophecy about Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth and his persecution of the Jewish people, and in particular those Jews who were faithful to the Word of God and who were actually instructing the Jewish people with regards to the Word of God. And undoubtedly, as I've been bringing out, they taught the book of Daniel and the prophecies here in chapter 11, because they were related to what they were going through at that time. God had already predicted in the 6th century B.C. through this unidentified angel speaking to Daniel what would take place during this period of history when Antiochus Epiphanes IV would be reigning over the Middle East and terrorizing the Jewish people. He was also in opposition against God because he suspended the Mosaic system of worship, which was designed to bring glory and honor to Yahweh, the God of Israel, who the New Testament teaches us is the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So we left off last evening talking about persecution, and persecution is something that God's people have always faced throughout the centuries, whether it's in the Old Testament or in the New Testament here in the church age. This will be the case in the future with the 70th week. And so this will be the case all the way up to the second advent of Christ. And the reason why we have persecution is because there's a devil, and because of the presence of the sin nature and negative volition to the Word of God, we have this persecution of God's people. Remember, the Spirit wars against the flesh, and Satan wars against the Spirit as well. So God's people manifest His kingdom. They're the mediators of His kingdom. And so therefore, Satan is opposed to God's people because the kingdom of God is manifested through His people on planet Earth. And as you heard me say in the past, believers are in enemy territory because Satan is temporarily the god of this world. 2 Corinthians 4:4, he deceives the entire world. 1 John 5:19, Revelation 12:10, and therefore he is opposed to us. He's opposed to the church. Paul made that clear in a great passage in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 19. So we're going to continue a discussion of persecution and also undeserved suffering. We'll be noting in this next Tuesday as well, and how we have, as church age believers, we have to go through at times undeserved suffering. And we see that a couple of reasons why that is. In the past, last evening, and in the past, we've seen this, it's to test our faith and also develop more of the character of Christ in our lives. And also, ultimately, God wants to bring glory to Himself through our suffering, because when we're weak, we're strong. His omnipotence is manifested in our human weakness. So we'll have some more to say about that this evening. So persecution, by way of definition, persecution is the suffering or pressure, and this definition will be on our PDF document that will go on our website with the exposition and exegesis of verse 34 of Daniel chapter 11. Persecution is the suffering or pressure, mental, moral, or physical, which authorities or individuals or crowds inflict on others, especially for opinions or beliefs, with a view to their subjection by recantation, silencing, or at least at last resort, execution. That's a big definition. Let's take a little bit of it piece by piece. Persecution is the suffering or pressure, mental, moral, or physical, which authorities or individuals or crowds inflict on others. So we've seen in the past, we saw last evening with Peter and John, they were told not to proclaim the gospel. They were arrested for it, and they were punished for it. They were physically attacked by the authorities, and they tried to get them to recant it, meaning stop teaching the gospel, and they refused to do so. So we see that this type of persecution is found in the Old Testament. We see it's found in the New Testament with Christians in the first century, the first and second centuries. And we see it today, even our day and age, with believers throughout the world. And of course, thank God, in the United States of America, we don't have this persecution like we have in other parts of the world. However, there's a drawback to that, because I believe that in our country, in the West, in specific, when I say the West, I mean in much of Europe, and definitely in America, in the North America, we see that we are very prosperous, and that is also actually works against us, because prosperity, the prosperity that we have in this country, has caused most of Christians today to not really take seriously their relationship with God, and they're very unfamiliar with persecution and undeserved suffering, because they are falling in love with the things of the world. Satan has duped many Christians today into thinking that the things of the materialism, the things of this world, the possessions that we have are basically the true source of happiness and where it's at. Of course, they've been deceived by the devil if they think that. Now, so therefore, Satan uses prosperity here in the West to get people away from being devoted to Jesus Christ, and you manifest that devotion by learning and obeying His word. But we see in other parts of the world that's really not the case, and so Satan wages war against the church in other parts of this country and in the world. And he uses even civil authorities, leaders in other nations, and not just governmental, you know, the national government, but also local governments persecute Christians throughout the world, whether it's in China or in Russia or in Africa. There's great persecution there too, or in Pakistan and India, where there's a lot of the Muslim extremists put to death people who go from convert from Muslim to Islam to Christianity. And so this is the reality. This is what's going on in the world. Great book to read is Fox Book of the Martyrs. You should pick up that book and see what it's really, the reality of the situation in the world today and what's going on. We're really in a bubble here in North America. So persecution is what others inflict upon us. They could be civil leaders, governmental, local governmental leaders, or national governmental leaders, or just people. It could be kids at school. It could be anything like that. It could be teachers at times. We've seen that with that movie that they just put out, God Is Not Dead, and that, you know, they ran the credits at the end of the movie, and it's a list of people who Christians who had to go to court to get their right to free speech in colleges and universities because they were being silenced by the evolutionists and the atheists and the agnostics. So that's going on in our colleges and universities. I'll tell you another thing. If you're a Bible-believing Christian and you're in academia today, and you know, I'm talking about colleges and universities, and even in medicine, a lot of people are actually persecuted for that. They don't get the jobs that other people in this that other people have who are not Christians, and that's quite frankly the liberal and the atheist is really got control of a lot of academia in America today and in Europe. So persecution takes on different forms. You could be persecuted and not get a job that you have qualified for, but because you're a Christian, you don't get the job. That's true in some countries. That's the case. So we have this persecution here in Daniel chapter 11, verses 29 through 35. This persecution that Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth waged against God's people, the Jews, and the second century BC. Now it says in Daniel chapter 11, verse 29, at the appointed time, he, and that's the despicable king of the north, who history tells us was Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth, at the appointed time he will return in order to wage an attack against the south, against Egypt. However, it will by no means turn out like the first invasion, which was in 170 BC, or the last, the second invasion, which was in 169 BC, because ships of Kittim, that's the Romans, will come against him. They'll confront him. The Roman delegation representing the Roman Senate confronted him outside Alexandria and told him, we don't want you here in Egypt. Please leave. And he did, and he wasn't happy about it. Then it goes on to say, consequently, he will be intimidated so that he will retreat. He retreated because he didn't want to have war with Rome. His father lost that war, if you recall. Then it says, he will vent his anger against the Holy Covenant, the Mosaic system of worship in Israel, so that he will take action. That's military action. When he returns, he will also show partiality for those who abandon the Holy Covenant. And he's going to develop that whole thing about these unfaithful Jews in verse 34. Then it says in verse 31, even military forces will be mustered by him in order to cause the holy place, that's the temple, the place of refuge, to be defiled. Specifically, they will cause the daily sacrifice to be abolished. They will even erect an abomination resulting in desecration. The abomination was a image of Zeus in the temple, which he demanded that the Jews worship. So that was the abomination that resulted in the desecration of the temple. Then it says in verse 32, also those who violate the covenant, he will pervert with flatteries. However, those who know their God experientially will resist so that they will take action. That's a reference to the Maccabean revolt, which is documented in 1st and 2nd, 3rd Maccabees, which is not found in your Protestant Bibles, which we have is a Protestant Bible, but a Catholic Bible. You'll see that in between the covenants. Actually, the New Revised Standard Version has the 1st and 2nd and 3rd Maccabees in there. They weren't considered a part, those books weren't considered a part of the canon of scripture, as you heard me say in the past. They weren't considered by the Jews to be in the Old Testament or the New Testament. The church did not believe those to be inspired, and they didn't include them in the canon of scripture. However, they give us a lot of good information, historical information, about this period of time that we're reading about in Daniel chapter 11. So then it goes on to say, he says, however, those who know their God experientially will resist so that they will take action. Indeed, verse 33, those who are wise from the people will cause the masses to be instructed. However, for a period of time, they will be killed by the sword, by the fire, by captivity, as a result of being made a prisoner of war. So those who are wise from the people who cause the masses to be instructed is actually a reference to what we call the Hasidim, and specifically those who were teachers of the law, the Mosaic law. A lot of them were priests. Remember Mattathias, who started the Maccabean revolt against Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth. He was an old man. He was a priest of from Jehoiarib, a priestly family, and he was lived in a place called Modin, which is outside Jerusalem, and he killed a Syrian officer and a Jew who was attempting to practice a pagan sacrifice. And then his son took over after his death, Judas. He was called Judas Maccabeus, and Maccabeus is, the Maccabees is a name, a nickname basically, which means the hammer. So Judas was a great military commander by default. He was the leader of this revolt against Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth. And this revolt is also called, as you heard me say in the past, the Hasmonean Revolt, because it's named after Judas's family and Mattathias's family, his father. So we see that they're persecuted. These people who taught the word of God, and undoubtedly they taught the book of Daniel, because Daniel predicted this persecution. So they taught the book of Daniel, and we see that they were put to death by various methods, whether it's by war or the torture, being burned at the stake, or captivity. They died a prisoner of war. They died for their faith in the Lord and their being dedicated to him and not giving in to the persecution, not compromising. And again, this was undeserved suffering for blessing, and it was also designed to test their faith. And we'll touch on these things, because this is true of us too with undeserved suffering. It tests our faith, and it also develops more godly character in us, and perseverance and endurance. Then it says in verse 34, but when they are being killed, they will receive a little help. However, with empty words from hypocrisy, many will join them. Now, the New American Standard translates verse 34. Now, when they fall, they will be granted a little help, and many will join with them in hypocrisy. Now, that very first statement, when they fall, they will be granted a little help, is an adversative clause. And it stands in contrast to the previous statement that stated for a period of time, those Jews who were wise would be killed by the sword, by the fire, by captivity, as a result of being made a prisoner of war. So therefore, if you compare that statement, first statement in verse 34, with the last one in verse 33, the contrast is between these wise Jews being killed for resisting to the decrees of the despicable king Antiochus, and they're receiving help when they're being killed by this wicked king. Or in other words, the contrast is between having no apparent help and in fact having a little help to fight this wicked king. So the New American Standard thinks it's an adversative, a transitional statement. That's why they begin the verse with the word now. But the conjunction while there, if you compare that first statement, which it introduces in verse 34, with the second, there's obviously a contrast there. So I would translate the now, the conjunction wa, with the word but, because that's how we figure out this is an adversative clause. The New American Standard translators didn't see it that way. Now, we see that they have a little help. These people who are faithful to God, who are teachers of the Word of God, they taught the people the Word of God in Israel. They taught them the law. They taught them the book of Daniel. They encouraged and exhorted and challenged their people to be faithful to God despite the persecution from Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth. And so we see here that they have a little help, but this help is really all from the people who are joining them are really doing it out of hypocrisy. Now, when it says when they fall, that's composed of the preposition beth, translated here when, and then we have as its object the verb kashal, translated fall. We saw this in the past last evening. It speaks about physical death. And then we have the third person masculine plural pronominal suffix hema, which means they. Now, this pronominal suffix, hema, it's correctly translated, and it's referring, again, to those wise Jews who resisted the decrees of the despicable king ruling the north And they remained faithful to the God of Israel by obeying the 613 commands and prohibitions of the Mosaic Law. So when it says when they fall, again, that's speaking of the people we saw in verse 33 that were teachers of the word of God. Now, as was the case in verse 33, this verb kashal, translated fall here in verse 34, literally means to fall, but it's used in a figurative sense for being killed by an enemy in combat. Now, the preposition bath is prefixed to the infinitive construct form of this verb. It's a temporal marker, and thus we should translate it when, since it's marking marking those who were wise in Israel, receiving a little help when they are being killed by this despicable king ruling the north. When it says they will be granted a little help, that indicates that those who joined the wise Israelites, who were teachers of the word of God, to fight the king of the north, only supported them to a small degree. So when it says they will be granted a little help, the help they received from these people who were joining out of hypocrisy to save their own necks was really just a little bit of help. It was a small degree to which they helped. Now then it says, and many will join with them in hypocrisy. That's telling us why this group came to help. They didn't help because of sincere motives. They join out of hypocrisy and reality because they wanted to save their own lives. So that phrase, and many will join with them in hypocrisy, that stands in contrast with the previous prophetic statement. Therefore, the contrast is between the wise in Israel resisting the king of the north, receiving a little help, and that little help is provided only by those who join in hypocrisy. Now, when it says many will join with them in hypocrisy, that refers to those who join the Jewish resistance, the Maccabean revolt, and they do so out of hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is pretending to be something that you're not. The Pharisees, that was the great sin of the Pharisees. We as Christians are commanded in the Word of God not to get involved in hypocrisy. Romans 12, we studied that in the past. So hypocrisy comes from a word, a Greek word, it means putting on a mask. So when the Greeks, they used to do great theaters and had great amphitheaters, and they would put on all these plays. And they didn't have the makeup that we have today in our country, you know, in our movies, but they would use these masks, and they would put the masks up in front of them, and you were a hypocrite. Now, this is what the idea of this word came from. Just like the actor pretended to be somebody that he was not, he was playing a character, so someone who's involved in hypocrisy pretends to be something that they are not. That was one of the great sins of the Pharisees, as I said, that Jesus really went after. So we really have to be careful of hypocrisy as well as Christians. We're warned against it. Now, when it says in hypocrisy, it's an interesting phrase. It's a prepositional phrase because we have the preposition bath, and then we have the word kalak laka. Kalak laka is translated here hypocrisy. It's in the plural. It actually literally means empty words, but it's used in a figurative sense, so we would say hypocrisy here because it pertains to faking to be what one is not, or to believe what one does not, and the false assumption or an appearance of virtue or religion. So here it refers to the hypocrisy of many of those who will join the Jewish resistance against Antiochus Epiphanes IV in the sense that they will feign, F-E-I-G-N. You don't know what it means? It means this, to fake you're something that you're not. Feign, you're faking something. So this word speaks of the hypocrisy of those who joined the Jewish resistance. They were Jews, and they joined in hypocrisy in the sense that they faked that they were loyal to the God of Israel. They faked that they were sincere in obedience to God when they were not. So the word here is the object of the preposition bath, which functions as a marker of manner, and thus it's expressing the manner in which this is accomplished, that they joined the resistance. Specifically, it expresses the attitude of many who joined the resistance, indicating that with empty words, from hypocrisy, many Jews would join the resistance and fighting Antiochus Epiphanes IV. So it says in verse 34, but when they are being killed, the Jews who are instructors of the law, in verse 33, who are being put to death, they will receive a little help. However, with empty words from hypocrisy, many Jews will join this resistance. Now, if you recall, in verse 33, the angel of God tells Daniel, he prophesied, that those who are wise among the citizens of the nation of Israel will, for a period of time, be killed by the despicable king ruling the north. This was fulfilled again through Antiochus Epiphanes the IV, who put to death these men in Israel who were faithful to the word of God, who instructed the rest of the citizens of the nation of Israel to resist this wicked king's attempt to Hellenize the nation. So they were calling the nation again to justified civil disobedience. What's that? If I ask you the question, hopefully you'll be able to answer it with a question and answer session, because I'm going to ask some questions. So to see where you guys are at, justified civil disobedience means that when the nations of God, the laws of God and the laws of the country conflict, you're to obey God, not the laws of the land. We saw that in Acts chapter 6. Again, we saw it with Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the book of Daniel in chapter 6 and 3, respectively, and the Hebrew midwives in the beginning of the book of Exodus. So this is something that God's people have had to practice from time to time. We don't have any situation right now, conditions in our country, in America, where that's we have justified civil disobedience, thank God. So here, these men who are teachers of the word of God, they're saying, he's telling us to not obey the Sabbath, he's stopping the sacrifices, he's wrong, we're going to obey God, and we're going to continue to observe the Sabbath, we're going to continue to observe circumcision, we're going to continue to worship our God, and we're going to defy him, because where God says, when the laws of the land are telling us to disobey him, we're obeying God and not the laws of the land. So that's what we have going on here. So these Jewish men were wise because they instructed the citizens of Israel to remain faithful to God by continuing to obey the 613 commands and prohibitions of the Mosaic Law. So wisdom, is this passage is telling us that wisdom is manifested and when someone calls their fellow believers to obedience to God. A wise man or a wise woman does that. That's wisdom. And that's what God wants us all to be. We achieve wisdom, acquire wisdom, through the intake of the word of God. Not just hearing it, but putting it into practice in our life. In fact, wisdom is the application of God, knowledge of God in his ways and his commands and prohibitions. So that's what we have going on here with this, with these guys being wise. They were wise because they instructed the people to obey God rather than this tyrant. So Antiochus outlawed the scriptures, as we pointed out. He put to death anyone who possessed a copy of them. He also put to death those who would practice circumcision and observe the Sabbath, both of which are commanded in the law. He put a stop to the Levitical sacrifices in the temple, and he substituted them with the worship of the god of the Greeks, Zeus. Now, these wise men, and they were brave and courageous because of their great faith in the word of God. They were put to death by the sword, by fire, by captivity, as a result of being made prisoners of war. So how do you get courage? I'm talking about a godly courage. There are a lot of people who have courage and they fight for their country and they die for their country or they risk their lives for people. But there's a godly courage that's based upon the power of the Holy Spirit. It's a courage that we read about in Hebrews chapter 11. We get this courage from the word of God. Remember, faith appropriates the power of God. Remember, Jesus said, if you had just a little bit of faith, you'd be able to move mountains. They were trying to exercise a demon out of a boy, and they couldn't do it. And Jesus said, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, at that time, the smallest seed known to man at that time, you would be able to move mountains, meaning do the impossible. And so faith, what he's saying is that faith appropriates the power of God. It's not how much faith you have, it's who you have your faith in. So we get faith. Faith comes by hearing the word of Christ, the word of God, and faith appropriates the power of God. And that when you appropriate the power of God, faith in the word of God appropriates the power of God. The word of God is alive and powerful. Hebrews 4:12. You can overcome any adversity. And this is something I want to develop here a little here this evening. So let's first take a look at a passage which talks about faith appropriating the power of God. Hold your place. Look at Matthew Now, I wasn't planning going there this evening, but I think I know where it is. So if I take a little walk, yeah, okay. Look at Matthew 17, verse 14. Matthew 17, 14, when they came to the crowd, a man came up to Jesus, falling on his knees before him, saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he's a lunatic. I know a lot of fathers can say that about their sons. He's a lunatic. Heal him. But lunatic is not what we think. Like, he's a crazy kid. He's, you know, he's nuts, and he's a mental case. We called him back in Massachusetts when I was a kid. He was a wacko. But this is not talking about that. He's not talking about a mental disorder. He's just doing freaky things. And he goes on to explain what he means. For he often falls into the fire and often into the water. I brought him to your disciples, and they could not cure him. And Jesus answered and said, you unbelieving. Notice he's rebuking them because of their lack of faith. And perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Notice that Jesus was exasperated with them. You notice every time Jesus is exasperated, it's because we don't have faith. The apostles didn't have faith. His disciples didn't have faith. People didn't have faith. That really bugs God. What does it say in Hebrews 11? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So think about that. The next time you and I get worried, we should think about that. God really does get upset. The Lord would get upset with us. So just try to imagine. I'm going to try to do this more often. Imagine the Lord sitting in the chairs. You're getting home and you're worried about, you know, some kind of, you know, financial thing or bill or whatever, or some kind of thing that's going on. You just say, you know, Lord, your word says not to be anxious about anything, but I'll pray and give it up to you, and I'm going to have faith in you and trust in you. And imagine he's there sitting there, and he is, quite technically, and just say, hey, if that helps you do this, you know, to walk by faith, because that pleases him. He loves when we have faith in him and trust in him. So he says, how long you, so he goes on to say, bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked him, and the demon came out of him. And the boy was cured at once. So he's demon-possessed. That's why he was doing the wacky things. Then disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why could we not drive it out? And look what he says to them. He said to them, because of the littleness of your faith, for truly I say to you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible to you. Now don't miss this. He doesn't talking about us moving literally a mountain. He's not going to want you to do that. He likes the mountains where they are. Jesus did this. It's called, all the teachers, great teachers do this, but Jesus did this a lot. He uses what we call hyperbole, an exaggeration to make a point. And the exaggeration is this. If you just had a little bit of faith, a tiny little bit of faith, you could have solved this problem. The demon would have come out of you, out of the kid. But it didn't, because you don't have faith, enough faith. In fact, you don't have any faith. That's why he calls them unbelieving. So he says, because of the littlest of your faith, for I truly say to you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, the smallest seed in the ancient world at that time, known in the ancient world at that time, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible to you. So the moving of the mountains, this means whatever the adverse for the apostles, the disciples, it was this demoniac, this kid who was indwelt by this demon. That was the mountain. To move the mountain is impossible, right? He's saying that was an impossible thing for them. It didn't get resolved because they didn't have faith. The littleness of your faith. And he's saying to them, and think about this, he said, if you had the faith the size of a mustard seed, so really, they really had a problem with faith. And so that's, he's saying, the lack of faith, that's why you didn't have the power to remove the demon. Faith appropriates the power of God. So that's what he's saying to them. If you had just the faith the size of a mustard seed, you'd be able to move, do the impossible. You'd have the power to do the impossible, cure this, what's humanly impossible, cure it. So you appropriate God's power with the word of God. By faith in the word of God. Faith in the word of God. Look at Matthew chapter 10. How do we get this faith? A lot of people don't seem to have faith. I hear other Christians say, this person has a lot of faith. I wish I had that kind of faith. You could if you wanted to. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of Christ. You only have the faith because it's your fault. It's not because of anybody else's fault but you. And I can't stand when I hear Christians say that. You know, they don't have, you don't have that faith because you don't care about God's word. Because if you did, and if they're a baby believer, I'm not going to say that. But if they're a Christian for a number of years, you know, 20 years, I'm going to be saying something to them. And gentleness. Come on. You can do this too. You can have great faith. It's all about how much effort you're going to put into your study of your Bible and putting it into practice. Romans 10:17. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. That's simple, right? So if you want your faith to grow, continue to learn the word of God. Hear the word of God. And the word there, hear, don't miss this. It doesn't simply just meaning take in the information. It actually is, the word there speaks of actually applying what you learn. That's how they were used hearing there in the New Testament. Go now to Hebrews chapter 11. And we have chapter 11 is God's Hall of Fame of Faith. And we touched upon this chapter, verses 35 through 38, which has some references, veiled references to the leaders of the Maccabean revolt. Those who were these people we're studying about in Daniel chapter 11, verses 33 through 35. Now look at Hebrews chapter 11, great chapter on faith. It's called God's Hall of Fame of Faith, and it defines faith for us, and it gives a lot of examples throughout Old Testament history of people who had faith in God and brought glory to God. So we know how we get faith. Now, what is faith? Well, Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For instance, I believe that Jesus will raise me from the dead because he says that. Now, I haven't seen a person raised from the dead. I've never seen Jesus face to face. I've never seen it in history, but I believe he will do that, even though I have never seen a man raised from the dead. I believe he will raise me from the dead. So faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Conviction, very important word. It speaks of, conviction speaks, you have a confidence. There's certain things you should have conviction. I have a lot of convictions. And you have your convictions. Our convictions need to be based upon an accurate knowledge of the Word of God. So God wants us to have conviction about certain things. So faith is the assurance of things hoped for the conviction of things not seen. For by it, faith, the men of old gained approval, the men of the Old Testament. Now here we go with the examples. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. None of us saw the creation, and there's not a human being on the face of the earth that saw the creation of the heavens and the earth, nor did they see the restoration after the fall of Satan, the judgment of Satan, nor did they see that restoration. How do we know it happened? We have faith in what the word of God says. By faith, we understand the worlds were prepared by the word of God so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible, because God's invisible, right? He's spirit. By faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous, God testifying about his gifts, and through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. And that's the first person in God's family, Abel, who had suffered persecution for his faith. Abel's the first guy. And Jesus mentions him in the Gospels. He's the first guy to be persecuted for his faith. His brother persecuted him and killed him. His own blood, his own brother. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death. And he was not found because God took him up. That's the first rapture, really, in history right there. For he obtained the witness that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. And without faith, this is why Jesus got mad at his disciples and people in his own hometown. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. The people who died at the hands of Antiochus Epiphanes IV, the great teachers of the word of God, who were put to death, they believed that God would reward them. In fact, 1st and 2nd Maccabees records these men and women expressing that very fact. Then it says in verse 7, by faith, Noah, being warned by God about things not yet seen, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household, by which he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. Remember, rain had never fell on the earth before. So it's so funny now they're saying science, they believe that they found vast ocean underneath the earth. You know, that doesn't surprise me. I mean, isn't what the Bible said in Genesis? What do you think those vast fountains of water came up from? Came underneath the earth, it says in Genesis. And it rained for the first time. Precipitation took place. So Noah is building an ark, and they're all saying, a flood? Think about the people. For 120 years, he was working on this ark, by the way, preaching the gospel, and nobody got saved except his own family. And think about that. And he had faith that God was going to do what he said he was going to do. But everybody thought he was whacked out. Sometimes when you have faith in God, sometimes, let me tell you something, and I've known this in my life, and you will learn it if you haven't already. I'm sure some of you have already gone through this and know what I'm talking about. And some of you haven't, and you're going to find it's going to be cool when you run into it. Sometimes God's going to call you to do things that everybody's going to say, you're out of your mind. You're crazy. What do you think Abraham did? Abraham, I'm going to show you a country. Abraham, where are you going? I'm going to a land God's going to show me. Where is it? I don't know yet. He hasn't told me. You know, he left his whole family for that. That's faith. You think his friends and his family members were going, who are all idolaters, by the way, according to Joshua 24:2. You think they were all saying, oh, you're a smart guy? No, Abraham. No, they all thought he was crazy. You're crazy. You're going west and you're leaving everything, your family and friends and everything behind to go to a place that God, who you don't even see, hasn't even shown you or told you where it is. You're just going to pick up and go? Yep. What do you think Abraham was called? The father of our faith, because his whole life was marked by faith. A good article to read on our website, and I don't charge you a dime for it. It's a story of Abraham. Download it sometime. You learn a lot. So by faith, Noah, look what it did. He pleased God. By faith, verse 8, Abraham, when he was called, obeying by going out to a place which he was to receive for inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. Eventually, God told him where he was going. By faith, he lived as an alien in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise. For he was looking for the city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, even Sarah herself received ability to conceive, even beyond the proper time of life, since she considered him faithful who had promised. She was an old lady when she got pregnant. Abraham was an old man. Grandmothers and grandfathers, they don't, a hundred-year-old person and a 90, was it, how old is she? 90 years old. They don't have babies. But they did. I've never seen an old person have a kid. Well, it happened. They had faith. I mean, you think about it. First, Sarah thought this was nuts, of course, wouldn't you? But eventually she believed in it, because it couldn't have happened, having a child in her old age, if she didn't have faith in the Lord. You don't appropriate the power of God with unbelief. So again, it sounds crazy, but they got the kid. Nobody ever seen a person have a baby in their old age, but it happened. Now, then it goes on to say, therefore, verse 12, there was born even of one man, and him as good as dead, sexually dead, as that as many descendants as the stars of heaven in number, and innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. He was an old man when he finally had his first kid through Sarah. I mean, of course, he had Hagar and Ishmael. But this was through his wife, Sarah. And he has descendants, biological, spiritual. the Arabs call him father. The Christian calls him father. And the Jew calls him father. And yet he was a guy whose first kid didn't come around until he was an old man. Faith, baby. Verse 13. All these died in faith, without receiving the promises, but having seen them, and having welcomed them from a distance, and having confessed that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For those who say such things make it clear they're seeking a country of their own. So they had faith in the rewards and heaven and the New Jerusalem, even though they hadn't seen these things. They didn't get the promises yet, but they had faith that God would deliver on them. They had faith that God would raise him from the dead, even though it hadn't taken place. Look at verse 15. And indeed, if they had been thinking of that country from which they went out, they would have an opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, heaven, that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises was offering up his only begotten son. It was he to whom it was said, in Isaac your descendant shall be called. He considered that God is able to raise people even from the dead, from which he would also receive him back as a type. Don't miss that. It's saying when Abraham walked up that mountain, Mount Moriah, where the temple would eventually be built, and it's still there today, Temple Mount area, he walked up there knowing, this was in his head, I'm gonna sacrifice my son, and he wasn't a little kid, he was in his 30s, Isaac, we went over that, and Isaac goes up there, and Isaac had faith to do this too, to lay down his life there. It's a picture of the father and the son, by the way, Abraham and Isaac. We studied that too in Genesis. You know what Abraham was thinking? Although I'm going to sacrifice him, God's having me sacrifice him, I believe that God can raise him from the dead. So even though I'm going to kill him, I know God's going to raise him from the dead. Now, God had no intention of killing the guy, but to test his faith, to see if Abraham would value his child more than his obedience to him. So we see here that God tested Abraham. That's a crazy thing. Again, I told you again, sometimes God has us do things that seem like people are going to think you're crazy. I mean, if anybody asked Abraham, what are you going to do? Oh, I'm going to go sacrifice my son. What? But God leads us to places of testing. And we don't always understand why. If you haven't got, some of you are too young to know this. Maybe some of you, maybe you're not. But I think as an adult, those adults have been walking with the Lord any time here. You know what I'm talking about. You're sitting there and you're some things you're saying in your life. Why is God not doing this here? Why am I still without this? Why is this still happening in my life? What? You ask questions. If you're walking with God long enough, you're going to sit there and you're going to have two choices. Get mad at God and bitter at God. Or you say, you know what? Father knows best. I trust God. I don't understand what you're doing, God. Actually, I do. You're trying to develop the character of Christ in my life. So I'm just going to trust you. And if you sent your son to the cross for me when I was your enemy, I know you're going to freely give me all things and you have my best interests in mind. If you did the greatest thing for me when I was your enemy, now.